Well, today my conversation is with Eva Aridjis. Go ahead and hold up your book for me. Award-winning filmmaker, writer, and author of the book MONARCA, a fable about a Mexican-American girl with kind of a mystical bond with a monarch butterfly. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Thanks for having me.
Well, you know, there's something magical about butterflies for me, at least they always have been. And I remember when I made a personal transformation, someone gave me a card that said, just when the caterpillar thought the world was over, she became a butterfly. And That's kind of how it is. Even the beginnings of this book, right, Eva? I mean, the serendipity of how you and Leopoldo, got together. But could you share a little bit about the story of Leopoldo and his daughter?
Well, Leopoldo's daughter's named Ines, and she inspired the main character in the book, the girl who turns into Monarch Butterfly. And my daughter's named Josephine, and she inspired the main butterfly character. So it's very much a family labor of love, this book. And Leopoldo and I are both Mexican filmmakers living in New York and friends. And he had the wonderful idea of writing a book about a Mexican-American girl who transforms into Monarch Butterfly and undertakes the migration to Mexico. And he didn't realize when he asked me to write it with him that my father, Homero Aridjis, who's also a writer, was responsible for the creation of the Monarch Butterfly sanctuaries in his home state of Michoacán. And he also features in the book as a character. When the butterflies get to Michoacán, there's a little boy named Homero who helps them. So we all grew up, I grew up watching the butterflies. Leopoldo grew up going to see the butterflies, took his daughter Ines. A butterfly landed on her head. I think that was the origin of the idea for him. So it's very much about, you know, the book is very much about family and heritage and our ancestors. But then it's very much about the butterflies and, as you say, metamorphosis, transformation. You know, when Ines turns into a butterfly, she undertakes the migration, the 3,000-mile migration to Mexico. And it's really about what she learns from the natural world as in her time as a butterfly. But for the reader, it's also about a guide to transformation using the four stages of a monarch's life, egg, caterpillar, chrysalis, and butterfly as sort of as the four stages of transformation.
Now your dad, you know, tell me a little bit about your dad, because he had to have ignited this passion for butterflies in you, right? He had to have.
So my father, Homero Aridjis, he grew up in Michoacán, which is, you know, the state where the butterflies spend the winter. And him and my mother had an environmental group called the Group of 100, which was writers and artists and intellectuals trying to help the environment. So I grew up going to see the butterflies with him whenever I would visit my grandparents in Michoacán. And it's really one of the wonders of the natural world. Not only the fact that these tiny insects undertake, you know, a journey of up to 3,000 miles and everything, all the obstacles, you know, they encounter along the way, the dangers. But then when you go to these forests, the Oyamil forests, where they spend the winter, just seeing millions upon millions of butterflies flying around and in clusters on the trees, roosting. I mean, it's really a glorious spectacle, which I think everyone should witness in person at least once in their life. So I grew up sort of with environmental, you know, parents who were writers and environmentalists. So this, obviously, I grew up with a very strong appreciation for nature and for words, for writing, and then sort of became an animal rights activist myself. I went vegetarian when I was 10. I'm a vegan now. We love all animals. From insects to farmed animals.
It's a beautiful world. I mean, the illustrations in the book. I saw the PDF. I didn't get the book, but I saw the PDF, and the illustrations in this book are just wonderful. Tell me about those.
So Leopoldo drew them. He's an artist as well. So our collaboration, we came up with the story. We sort of took turns writing, you know, there's four chapters. So we took turns writing the first draft and sort of working on it. And then about halfway through the writing, we made a list of the illustrations that he should make. And yeah, they're just gorgeous. So it's really it's sort of a graphic novel. We like to describe it as a graphic novel, a fable, an inspirational tale, because it's also a guide for transformation. And it's sort of for readers, you know, 8 to 108. It's sort of for all ages. And think of it as The Little Prince meets The Alchemist, you know.
I love that. The Alchemist is my favorite book.
Oh, really?
Okay. Oh, absolutely. I've read that numerous times. You know, there's something that I heard about called, I think it's the Monarch Butterfly Biosphere Reserve.
Yes.
Have you been there? And is this what you're talking about? Or what is that like?
Yeah. Those are the sanctuaries. Okay. That's the official name for the sanctuaries,
I'm in Michigan. Okay. In Michigan. And we've got, I found out, a well-known migratory way station that's at the southern tip of Stonington Peninsula in our upper peninsula here in Michigan. Are you familiar with it?
Well, I know that they've, a lot of the butterflies, there's several routes, but they fly over the Great Lakes and, you know, they really, sort of people all over the United States, have monarch butterflies coming through their state. So there's two populations. There's the Western population that originate in Northwestern Canada and California and spend the winter sort of along 20 to 30 different sites on the Californian coast. And that population has plummeted 99% in the past 25 years from millions to in 2020, there were less than 2,000. Population did bounce back a bit last year. And the eastern population, which is the larger one, which originate in Canada, the northeastern United States, and make their way to Mexico, the fourth generation each year. And there's different routes. So some go along, you know, the eastern seaboard, others go through the Great Lakes, the Midwest, you know, they all kind of converge in Texas and fly into Mexico. You know, and that population is also in danger of extinction, but not quite as dramatic. About 85% have decreased in the past 25 years from a billion in Mexico, you know, in the late 90s to 60 million recent years.
So what do we do to bring back this population? I mean, it'll be hard to stop controlling, I guess, the chemical makers, but what can we do? Yeah.
So there's a whole section at the back of the book called Join the Swarm, which it tells us the situation, gives all the statistics and tells us, the readers, what they can do to help. And it's actually the most important thing that readers in the United States can do and is plant wildflowers and milkweed in your gardens, in your community centers, libraries, schools, museums, you know, by roads, any fields that you have. The monarch caterpillars can only eat milkweed. That's the only thing they eat. And the female monarchs will only lay their eggs on milkweed leaves. As you mentioned, you know, most of the milkweed in the country has been destroyed by, you know, it grows sort of next to corn and soybean farms. And Monsanto and Bayer producing this herbicide called Roundup, which is a glyphosate based, and it just destroys anything not genetically modified to resist it. So this has been terrible for pollinators, not only butterflies, but bees as well. So
once the butterflies and bees go away, so do we.
Exactly. So yeah, planting wildflowers for the butterflies and milkweed for the monarch caterpillars, wherever you can. Consuming organic avocados because that's in Mexico, the problem there in the sanctuaries is illegal logging to make way for avocado farms, which grow at the exact same altitude and in the exact same sort of climate as the oyamel trees, which the monarchs spend the winter sort of roosting on. And the avocado farms are kind of encroaching on the on the sanctuaries. They call avocados green gold now because, yes, you know, it's such a lucrative trade and it's being controlled by cartels now. But there is a whole collective of organic avocado farmers called Pragor. So just if you look for, you know, equal exchange organic avocados, which are grown by farmers who are not contributing to the logging in the sanctuaries and not using pesticides.
Yeah, some of our fruit and vegetable markets that we have here in the area do carry those organics. Yeah. So that's an option. I've been buying them for a while. I'd heard all about this. You know, it's interesting because you say the book is broken up into the four different mm-hmm. stages, which is the four different stages for the butterfly, but it's also kind of in parallel to the story. And so exactly. Ines is told a story or given something, I think, by her abuela, right? Is it her grandma, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Tell me how the beginning of the book starts.
So Ines turns 13 and receives a necklace, which has been passed down, you know, from one generation to the next, her father's side of the family, which her abuela Andrea sent from Michoacan for her. And shortly after receiving this necklace, she transforms into a monarch butterfly and undertakes the migration to Mexico. And when towards the end of the story, when she arrives in Mexico and speaks to her grandmother, she finds out why she transformed into butterfly. So we've created a sort of pre-Hispanic creation myth, if you will, using the four stages of a monarch's life. You know, we sort of use as a guide to transformation and change in the book, but the number four is very important because it's also the fourth generation of monarchs every year, which are the ones who undertake the migration to Mexico.
Mm.
The other three are sort of either traveling north from Mexico or spending the summer in the United States and Canada. And then it's the fourth generation who traveled to Mexico without ever having done this migration before. And so in our book, it's also the fourth generation in fourth generation girl in Ines's family is the one that transforms into monarch butterfly in order to help the butterflies with a plight that they have at that moment in time.
That's the thing. I mean, it's so, you know, Mexico has such a rich history, right? It's, and you've managed to kind of weave that through the book. Did you have to do a lot of research? Did you kind of know all of this already?
So we have, you know, our creation myth goes back to the Purépecha Indians, where the indigenous people in Michoacán, you know, in pre-Hispanic times, they were in the whole state. Now they're just in one part of the state. And they were one of the only indigenous tribes to resist the Aztecs. You know, the Aztecs were conquerors and they conquered and invaded most of the other pre-Hispanic cultures that they, you know, existed at the same time as them. But the Purépechas were one of the only ones that resisted it. So in our story, the butterflies on their way to Michoacán, you know, flying over different parts of Mexico, saw the Aztecs, you know, invading neighboring villages and were able to warn the Purépechas that the Aztecs were coming. And then in exchange for this favor, the Purépechas, you know, there's a girl every fourth generation that helps the monarch. So we researched, you know, Purépecha, the culture, and, you know, we found that there's butterfly deities in many pre-Hispanic cultures in Mexico. The butterflies were depicted in stone carvings and paintings. There's many different names for butterflies. Paracata is one of them that we use. And then obviously we did a lot of research about the monarchs themselves, about their migration, about their, you know, their feeding habits, their mating habits, the dangers they face, statistics. So it's been a wonderful journey for us as well of, you know, what we want for the reader to do is sort of connect to the natural world and to their ancestry and their heritage, be inspired by the book to do that. And we connected to the natural world and our ancestry through researching it and writing it.
Yeah, we've got a beautiful exhibit also at the Frederick Meyer Gardens here. It goes on every spring. It's called Butterflies Are Blooming. And they bring in, you can see kind of the whole life cycle, and you walk through this humid, you know, beautiful, warm environment when it's cold here in Michigan. I've walked through a few times where a butterfly has landed on me. I wore shocking pink. I wore some perfume thinking I would attract them. Yeah. No one came near me this time. But I'll tell you, you also talk about, this was a startling fact. You say that we're living through the sixth but first man-made mass extinction on this planet. And tomorrow, April 21st, is World Creativity and Innovation Day. And how does that tie into all of this?
Well, Friday also is Earth Day.
Yes. Right?
April 22nd. So we timed the release of the book to coincide with Earth Day. And the monarch butterfly is in danger of extinction. There's 200 species going extinct every day. And, it's so important to protect our planet and other species for our future generations, for our children, grandchildren, and for obviously for the species themselves. Pollinators, butterflies and bees are, you know, at great risk from pesticide use, from climate change. Visiting these butterfly centers, getting children and young people involved, and, you know, watching this, the amazing thing, which is the life cycle of a butterfly, which, you know, they go from, they enter the, you know, the monarch caterpillar when it goes into the chrysalis, you know, it completely breaks down into a soupy substance.
Yes.
And completely reforms as a butterfly, you know.
It's amazing. That's why I say it's magical. The whole process is just a magical thing. Butterflies for me. Eva, thank you so much for talking with me here today. Eva Aridjis, the new book, Monarca. Hold it up so everybody can remember the cover when they walk into their local bookstore to buy it. You can also get it online. Thank you for your time, and thank you for doing what you do. I learned so much.
Thank you so much. Take care.